outside, no man is safe from. You can run, but you can't hide forever from these streets that we done took. You walk away.
Today we'll be taking a look at number of hands played by Daniel Negreanu in the 25K Super High Roller Championship on GG. Daniel, of course, is one of the greatest MTT players of all time, and he's unique in that he's one of the few old-school players that has fully immersed himself in the world of modern theory. Of course, he spent many hours using solvers during his heads-up match with Phil Polk, and although the end result ultimately didn't go his way, it appears that those hours weren't spent in vain, and he scored a couple of very big wins since that match after a long drought. So in this video, we're going to see just how much he's learned, comparing his play to GTO solutions we've run by testing GTO Check's new manual input feature, which will be released very soon. And for this one, I'll not be doing any commentary. I'll simply let Daniel speak for himself and see how his logic stacks up against the solver.
Hit the flop. This is one this deep I'm going to go ahead and put in my raising range. Eight-handed. Again, part of the reason you do this from under the gun occasionally is board coverage. You want to make sure that, especially this deep, when you raise under the gun, your opponents can't be like, oh, wow, he must have, you know, ace-king, ace-queen, big pairs, all that kind of stuff. So when the flop comes 3-4-5, 6-6, stuff like that, then they can just own you. I'm going to check back this flop. I sometimes bet this, sometimes check it. From the small blind, his range should be pretty strong as well. I'm gonna check it. Not the best card in the deck for us. If we were ahead, he could have now like 9-10 suited, jack-9 suited type stuff. I don't think this is a bet, though. Nope. Okay, now pure check here. Okay. That's not a good card either. Now 10-jack beats us, too. This is a spot where it would be really difficult to call on the river. Because now we have to figure out what hand calls from the small blind that we now beat. Ace-10, ace-jack. I mean, we have plenty of showdown value against some suited aces, pocket sixes, pocket fives, whatever. So we just check. All right, ace-jack. Haha, don't mind if I do, y'all. Don't mind if I do. Take it down, D-negs. King-7 off. We'll defend this one. Again, this isn't a hand that plays all that well post either, but it is, you know, reasonable defend against the button for sure. Now we're going to check. We would check raise this flop sometimes, but typically if we were going to do that, we'd want to have like king seven suited with a backdoor flush draw. And this would be an okay spot. Against big, just fold anyway. He's betting big on that flop. 4.4. Considered big. King 10 off, queen jack off, king jack off. These are rookie hands. Those are why, that's probably why a lot of the rookies in the chat like fall for that shit in those spots. Checking. You know, oh, but you have two high cards. Yeah, but what do you think he has? Right? You want to hit one and then lose a bunch of chips? Like, this is going to be a check again. Remember now, Jane Co. saw me limp with kings, which is good. Saw me check it. So we're going to think that this 8 is good, but it's a little too thin for value, I think. Or maybe it isn't. Let's see. I could probably bet sometimes. I'm just going to check. We're going to check and call if he bets. 6 block. We block 6-10. We block 5-6. We don't block jack-10, but I would assume I would have heard from him a while ago if he had jack-10. Well, he's betting big now. That's interesting. All right, we have a bluff catcher, but I think we have a pretty good bluff catcher. Because it's like I said, I have that 6.
Yeah.
I think I'm just supposed to pay him off. Yes. Give me the maximum. Thank you. He bet with the 10 blocker. Okay, a couple of 8s. We will play this hand almost assuredly. Unless it goes raise and 3-bet, then we won't necessarily, because, you know, it's tough to jump. It's tough to really ever just jump the fence, which is jump the fence means like someone raises, someone 3-bets, and you just call. It's like a hard, it's hard to play that. It's hard to play any hands that way, because it's usually going to be eights, nines, tens, jacks, ace, queen, right? So against this raise, let's see, okay, I'm gonna flat. It's pretty active as well. Not as active as us. We are the most active player at the table. So for all of you, I fold king 10, I fold queen jack. Oh, you play so tight. I'm the loosest player at the table so far. About how many hands in? 25, or whatever. All right, we got a couple eights. It's a good board for us. All right, let's see. I don't think we can ever raise this swap. Just always gonna be a call. Okay, and it's gonna be another call. And we might actually check this back too, on turn. So right now, I mean, he could have nines plus, he could have a ace five suited, he could have pocket sixes, pocket threes. There's a lot of hands that do beat us. So against big size, we're like in jeopardy, right? This could be problematic. It's too good to fold, for sure. It's not good enough to raise, so we'll just call. And there's a four. All right, so now that could slow him down, right? Like, he's got to be concerned about a seven, pocket sevens, 7-8. I block 7-8. So one of the hands that he could have opened with bet as a bluff is 7-8 suited. But I have two eights, so that doesn't leave a lot of combinations of eights. So here on this river, I think this is a good check. I don't think he's going to call with worse, right? So I would be value cutting myself. So here, we're just thankful. Hopefully we check it back, and the eights are good, and he just had ace high. If not, you know, we lose. We're not going to bluff him off a better hand, that's for sure. Okay. Bravo, we'll take it. That was a good river card. All right, thanks. Okay, Oscar Brown. I feel you. All right, let's see. Are we going to raise this one? Yeah. We are going to put some money in with the 5-4 suited in position deep. This is a hand that we can actually call if he limp raises. Some limp raises he may have, as little as like ace 9, stuff like that. All right, that's a decent flop for us. So I'm going to go ahead and bet small. 27% C bet on this flop. It's a decent flop, right? We got a gut shot, we got a pair, we got backdoor spades, we got things that could happen. A three on the turn could be fun because it's gonna be more difficult for him to put me on one. He may represent one, but instead, we'll just take it down. Okay. That's a board where that's gonna happen a lot. They're just gonna check fold, right? What is he gonna do with jack 10, queen 10, queen 9, all kinds of shit, right? This is the theory here. We have ace queen suited, so we raise. That's the theory. This is pretty much, no, this is it. This is what we're doing with ace queen suited. We're not imposing a limping strategy this deep. All right, so we've been three bet. He's been three betting a lot. I mean, again, it's only 36 hands, but as you can see, that's a big high percentage of three bets. So we just have a call here, always. I don't think I'm gonna four bet this one here. Flat, let's see the flop. All right, that's not our flop. We do have one spade, so against small, we will peel. Because again, this is a board we can actually represent a lot of stuff too. Pocket eights, pocket sevens, eight, nine suiteds type of hands, which we'll have more of than he does. Pocket sixes, pocket fives. So against small, which again, small is defined by half or less. I'm gonna go ahead and make this call. We got some intentions of bluffing out ace king here as well. And representing some turn cards that roll off, like a four, seven, or a nine. So I'm gonna call this bet. Normally this is a spot where, you know, in the big blind or something, you can lead this middle card, but this is in a hand where we have a lot of 6x. We have some. I'm gonna check. I think if he bets again on this in this spot, we'll probably just have to surrender. Because he could be re-raising. He could be raising, of course, with hands like 6-7 suited himself. Occasionally. Not that that's, you know, the only threat. Obviously, aces, kings, queens, and now against the very big bet, I'm just gonna have to let him take it. And if there was a 10, so we completely whiffed. So here, we don't beat a whole lot.
So obviously most of these hands are pretty standard, but the important takeaway, in my opinion, is that by being able to hear Daniel's thought process, even in very mundane spots, it's quite clear that he definitely has a strong understanding of GTO principles. We heard him talk about range construction, equity distributions, card removal, mixing strategies, etc. And when you couple an understanding of theory with all of the years of exploitative experience Daniel has under his belt, it really makes for a potent combination that I think bodes well for Daniel's future results. So I guess sometimes an old dog can learn a few new tricks.
Survival of the fit, only the strong survive. Yeah, yeah. We live